Okay guys, in this video tutorial from the series of microscopy lectures, we'll be talking about the transmission electron microscopy. We've been talking about different types of microscopy procedures, and not actually procedures, we're mainly focusing on the microscopy principles. So we have seen the light microscopy principles, we have seen the electron microscopy, like the scanning electron microscopy. Now this one is the transmission electron microscopy, or better known as TEM. TEM, the short form of transmission electron microscopy. Now, just like the other type of electron microscopy, in this case of transmission electron microscopy, we use electron as an illumination source compared with the light microscopy, because in light microscopy we use light as the illumination source, but in TEM we use electrons for that. The electron beams that are used in all the different varieties of electron microscope to illuminate specimen, and thus it creates an image of it. But in case of scanning electron microscopy, we use the particle nature of the electron. So we have a sample surface, and once you use that electron will just bounce off from that surface of the specimen. And as it bounces off, there is a detector to detect that, to find out the surface structure of that sample more importantly. So for that, same is used for scanning the surface area of the or surface structure of the sample. But on the other hand, in case of transmission electron microscopy, the idea here is to, we have the sample, but remember, in this case the sample is very thin, actually ultra slim sample should be required. And in that case, the electron that we use, it will pass through the sample, it will transmit through the sample. This is in case of transmission electron microscopy, or TEM, because the electron will transmit through that ultra thin sample or ultra thin specimen, which is very hard to prepare, right? And even actually in TEM, the preparation of sample specimen is more difficult than the handling of the TEM itself, right? So then the electron will transmit through it, and as the specimen is very thin, we can actually get very through that part, the electron, with the help of the idea that electron has much shorter wavelength. So in that case, electron can easily pass through, and electron is scattered by the presence of different proteins and different structural properties of the cell, and the detector can detect it, and it can create the image of that ultra thin segment in much more better higher resolution. So if you look at here in this principle, the idea always remains the same. That is, the electron is our first source. We need to drive that electron very fast. Remember, the process of electron, the structure of electron microscope and scanning microscope is kind of similar, because both of them should have a tunnel. Both of them should have a tunnel inside. Inside that tunnel, there will be all the structures associated. And that tunnel is a vacuum, because there shouldn't be any presence of air or air particle, because that will interfere with the movement of electron and electron scattering. The unwanted electron scattering will result. That we don't want. So the idea here is to maintain that chamber through which the electron will pass as vacuum. So we make that vacuum, and then electron will pass through it. But the idea here in TEM, that electron should have a much higher speed than in case of SEM, because in scanning electron microscope there is a particular speed of electron required, but in TEM we need much fast electron, because the more faster the electron is, the faster it will pass through the sample, and it can actually project the image somewhere there in the screen. There is a camera, CCD camera, CCD sensor, that will detect it, and it can visualize, we can visualize that thing in the monitor screen. So here the idea is that normally the wavelength of these electrons are kind of 1 lakh times shorter. 1 lakh times shorter wavelength of electron than the wavelength of light, right? So that's why it gives us much more resolution, much more resolving power than the light microscope, right? Actually, the light microscope can give us the resolution power of 200 nanometer. So we can use it for 200 nanometer thin specimen samples. And also it gives us the 2000x magnification power. This is for light microscope. But in case of transmission electron microscope, what we can achieve is that 0.2 nanometer resolving power or resolution. That is tremendous. I mean, very good resolution. so we can create much better resolution images. And also the magnification power is, in case of electron microscopy, is 2 lakh. I mean, not 2 lakh, actually 20 lakh, I believe. So 20 lakh times magnification is possible. So not only actually we can magnify the cell and the structure, the ultrastructure of the cell, but also we can actually visualize atoms. That, isn't it great? We can actually visualize the atom. We can find the position of the atom, where the atom is present and so. So we can actually find them with the help of transmission electron microscopy in this case. Not actually transmission, with the help of electron microscopy, though there are different type of electron microscopy that we should use in that case. But we can actually use the electron microscopy for that. But in TIM, we can receive this higher resolution power as well as a high magnification power. So better magnification with better resolution, obviously the first choice for us to start looking at very thin structures of cell, right? So the idea here is at the very beginning, if you look at the structure of the working mechanism, if you look at here, so there is an electron gun. That electron gun can be different types, so whatever we can use depend on the company we buy. The thing is that there is a filament in that gun. That filament, when it hot, which get heated up with huge heat, that filament start releasing electrons. So it starts releasing the electron, and that electron will continue its journey through that vacuum tube out there, and there should be the lenses. Remember, the lens that we use in this case, whatever lens we use in electron microscopy, either TEM or SEM, those lenses are made up with electromagnets. So they are all magnetic lenses, because here the idea is the electron is negatively charged, but the lenses that we see here, all of them are positively charged. All the time they're positively charged, so they are kind of anode. They behave like anode there, so that the electron can migrate towards the direction of that magnetic lens. And in this case of transmission electron microscopy, the coils, as you can see, the magnetic lens is made up with many of these magnetic coils. In case of scanning electron microscopy, there are fewer number of magnetic coils, but in case of TEM, we have more number of magnetic coils, because in this case, the more magnetic coil are there, the more magnetic field will be generated, and it will help the electron to be directed toward the place, and it also helps that electron to achieve very, very fast speed in that vacuum. And as it is no interference of air, the electron moves really, really fast, and then it hits ultimately with the specimen. Remember, so once it is inside the specimen, hit there, and then it is scattered to the specimen, because the idea here is the specimen is a very ultra thin sample, right? So the beam of electron that has been partially transmitted through that thin specimen carries the information about the structure of that specimen, and that's, we call it the spatial variation. So we call it a spatial variation, right? Due to the scattering of that image, the partial scattering of that image, or partial transmission of that image. So the image, whatever we got by the spatial variation here, is carrying the information, and that information is not enough to be recognized by the CCD. So we require certain type of other lenses, as you can see at the second set of lenses, which will amplify that signal, right? So these lenses will amplify the signal which is recorded after the spatial variation there, and that signal will be then projected to either CCD. The sensor CCD will catch this signal, and it will project it into computer screen or any projection screen, whatever it is, it will project it, and we can eventually see the structure of that ultra thin specimen, right? But the idea again remains the same in this case, because we are not directly seeing anything, but we allow the electron to pass, and depending upon the scattering effect, we can see. So for that, we need to prepare the sample very well. There are different stages of this transmission electron microscopy. Like, first is the electron source that we've talked about, then the magnetic lenses that we talked about, the image system, the sampler. These are the different components. But the stages, if we look at here, is the preparation of sample, and that is the worst part of transmission electron microscopy. Because preparation of the sample is the hardest part there. Because for the preparation of the sample, we need to fix it, we need to rinse it. Then after the fixing, we have post-fixation stages and all these things. We require certain metals to be applied as a coating. And we also require dehydration, because if there is any presence of water in the sample, this whole process will not work. So dehydration, then embedding, and then finally fixation of that sample to the slide. So all this process take a long time and very good expertise to handle that properly, right? So that's the limitation of using transmission electron microscope. So that's why we generally don't use the transmission electron microscope in more often in context of life science or biological applications. But it is important, and we can use it to look at the ultra thin structures of the cell, like the cilia structure, how the proteins are moving inside the cell, and all these things. But again, it is really, the whole system of transmission electron microscope as well as the scanning electron microscope are limited. Though we can visualize things in the atom level, but they are limited to the level that we cannot visualize a living cell, a working cell under this microscope. Because for this microscope, we need the sample preparation, and for the preparation of the sample, we need a dead sample. We need to fix it. We need to dehydrate it. So definitely the sample will be killed. So that is the disadvantage of using TEM there, right? So TEM is important for look at the internal structure. SEM is important for determining the surface structure of the cell or of the sample. So if you look at here, this is how this transmission electron microscope looks like. This is the whole microscope, and actually this whole setup is the part of the microscope. This is where the projection screen is placed, and this is where the electron gun is placed. So electron will flow from this direction to that. Sample will be placed somewhere here, in this case sample chamber, and we can see something here as well as in this monitor screen. And this is how the sample looks like under the TEM or transmission electron microscope. As we are not using any light source, and electrons cannot give us the idea of the light because we are not using any wavelength of light, so we cannot actually see colored images. We can only see the images in black and white like this. Okay, so you can see here the nucleus and all the structures, the endoplasmic reticulum sites are coming in or out. This is the Golgi apparatus, as you can see. These are the vacuoles that you can see inside the cell. Right, so this is how the transmission electron microscope looks like, and I hope that video is helpful for you to understand TEM. If you like the video, please subscribe, hit the like button, and share this video with your social groups and social friends. So that's it, guys. Thank you.